Hello students, and welcome to your English lesson. In today's video, we will be looking at section 4, chapter 4.3b, An Enemy of the People. Let us get to know a little bit about the writer. Henrik Johan Ibsen was born on 20th March 1828, and he died on 23rd May 1906. He was a Norwegian playwright, theater director, and poet. He was one of the founders of modernism in theater, and Ibsen is often referred to as the father of realism and one of the most influential playwrights of his time. That means the plays that he has written during his time has had a lot of influence upon the people and their thoughts and thinking process during the time that he wrote the plays. And hence, he is also referred to as the father of realism. In 1869, he began to write prose plays. Some critics would say that at this point in his life, he abandoned poetry and took up realism. So as I said, he was a poet as well, but at this time he just stopped writing poems and he started concentrating on writing plays. In 1874, he began what became a series of 5 plays in which he examines the moral faults of modern society. And the plays were The Pillars of Society, 4 major plays, that is A Doll's House, Ghosts, The Wild Duck, and An Enemy of the People. And An Enemy of the People is the one that we will be studying in our textbook today. Like all of Ibsen's plays, An Enemy of the People was originally written in Norwegian and is full of untranslatable wordplay. Students, Norwegian is a language. He was from Norway, and people who speak that language, the language in Norway, are known as Norwegian, and the language is known as Norwegian language. And he, since he was from that particular place, from Norway, he has written most of his plays in Norwegian language. But this particular play, that is An Enemy of the People, was written in such good way that it was very difficult for other writers to translate the way he had written, the words that he had used in his language, to use it appropriately in the other language, or to translate it appropriately in the other language. So that is why it is, you know, one of his noteworthy works, that is An Enemy of the People. And specifically, a number of the characters, titles, exist only in Norwegian bureaucracy. Okay, so some titles that he has used in his play, those are used only in the Norwegian bureaucracy. You don't have it in other governing system. And so it was very difficult for the other authors to translate his work in the most appropriate manner. Now, this classic play, however, was adapted by Arthur Miller in the year 1950. Okay, now let us get to know about the drama. First is the theme of the play. Like every play that we come across, or every drama that we come across, has a particular theme upon which the drama is based. Okay, so let us see this particular play, An Enemy of the People. What is the theme of this play? A realistic play by Ibsen. That is realistic in the sense, a play which is very true to the situation that it was written in. The society during that time was facing this particular kind of problem, and that problem is what the play is talking about. So it is all talking about realistic terms, about realistic situation in the society during the given time. So it was a realistic play which was written by Ibsen, and it boldly tackles the municipal politics. Okay, it is usually like, you know, when we write or when we talk about political system, we have to be very, very careful. So when Ibsen has written about so many things which exposes the municipal politics, so that is why it is known to be written in a very bold manner, because it takes a lot of courage when you talk about a particular social topic which deals about politics. So this talks about the municipal politics of a Norwegian town. Okay, it's a particular town. There's a particular town in Norway, and the politics in that particular town is exposed, and the hypocrisy and cowardice of the progressives and the democrats, like how they are being unjust, justful to the society, how they are being hypocrites, how they are being very cruel for their own profit or for their own gain is what is being spoken about. So when you are as a political leader, you have to not only think about your personal gains, but you have to think about the society, about the people that you are going to be with. Okay, but this particular play talks how this municipal politics, the political people, the progressives or the Democrats, how they are being very cruel and unjust to the people and thinking only about their own gains. So, like all the plays in this series, like we told, there are, you know, he has written 4 books in the particular series. So, out of all the plays, okay, moral conflict is a significant element. So, if you look at all the plays, like, you know, these plays, like I told you, The Pillars of the Society, The Doll's House Ghost, The Wild Duck, and Enemy of People, all these plays talks basically about the moral conflict, which is in the society today, which is a significant element. Okay, when we deal with our conscience and when we actually put it into silent mode and we do things which are not right, so that is what this series of plays speak about. It deals with the extent to which individual desires and beliefs are compromised by society. Okay, we have to compromise so many of our morals, our values, just because we want to have our own personal gains. Okay, so how that happens in a society is also exposed in this play. In particular, the play also focuses on the ways in which an individual can be ostracized by the society he is trying to help. So a particular person, if he is trying to help a particular people or his society, then how the society puts him into sideline or sidelines him and ignores him, and instead of praising, they criticize him. Okay, that is how is being focused. That is what is being focused in this particular play. Now, the theme of the play also, you will find that this play still is relevant to our times. Okay, now even Ibsen, if he has written this during that particular time, today also, if you look at the society that we are into, we find many of the things that are discussed in this play even relevant even today. Okay, today in our times also all these things happen, and Ibsen attacks the social evils of his time, notably the status of women. So what are the various things that he talks about? First, the status of women. Even that time it was not that good, and even today we know that the status of women is not that good. Okay, and the squeamishness of the 19th century about the open discussion of moral problems, like how we are still so not open towards the discussion of moral things. Okay, moral values, moral etiquettes, moral thoughts, all of these depend from person to person, and how we are so ignored by all of these things that are happening around us. So the basic theme, the major themes that are spoken about in this play is power and public opinion, individualism versus authority, social responsibility, freedom of expression or speaking the truth, failings of democracy, corruption and pollution. So these are all the particular things that are spoken about or that are highlighted in this particular play. And we will of course get to know how these things are spoken about or how these themes are shown out into the play. Now, before we get into what the play, the story in the play is all about, let us get to know about the characters. Who are the characters in this play? So the first character is Dr. Thomas. He is the main character over here. So Dr. Thomas Stockman, he's a medical officer of the municipal baths. Okay. Then his wife, Mrs. Stockman. Then he has a daughter whose name is Petra. She's a teacher. And then he has 2 sons, that is Legif and Morton. Okay, they are sons who are 13 and 10 years respectively. So this is the Stockman family. Now, Mr. Stockman also has a brother whose name is Peter Stockman. Okay, so he's Mr. Thomas, Dr. Thomas's elder brother, Peter Stockman. And he is the mayor of the town and chief constable, chairman of the Baths Committee. Okay, then we have Morton Kill. He's a tanner. Okay, he's supposed to be Mrs. Stockman's adoptive father. That is, Morton Kill had adopted Mrs. Stockman, that is Dr. Stockman's wife. Okay, she was an adopted child of Morton Kill. Okay, so he was her adopted father. Then we have Hofstad, who is the editor of the People's Messenger. It's a particular magazine or newspaper. So he's the editor of that. And we have Billing, who is a sub-editor. Okay, then we have Captain Horster, And we have Aslaksen, he is a printer. Okay. And there are many other men of various conditions and occupations. There are a few women and a troop of schoolboys, the audience at a public meeting. So this is the entire list of characters that we will be coming across in the play. So now let us get to know about the plot of the play. Now, what exactly happens throughout the play? So the play begins with the protagonist of the play, that is Dr. Stockman. Okay, like I told you, he was a medical officer of the municipal bath. So in that particular town, in that Norwegian town, they had this particular municipal bath, okay, like a particular bathing system where the people of the town could come and have bath and leave from there. Okay, so this was a common bath which was available for the people of the town. Okay, and Dr. Stockman was a medical officer of these baths. So this is one of the baths. So like that, there were few baths, public baths, municipal baths in that particular town. And he, Dr. Stockman, he was the medical officer. It was his responsibility to keep a medical check of the water in the bath, of the how the water is, if it is clean or it is unclean, or if it is safe for the people to have bath in it. Because of course, there are so many people who are coming and having bath in the same water body. So of course, he has to keep a watch over how the quality of water is. Okay. So he was the in charge person to see the medical officer to see or to look after the municipal baths. And he would suspect. Okay. So once what happened is he suspected that the bath water is contaminated. Okay, it has got spoiled. It is not safe, or it is unsafe, or it is not healthy for the people to have bath in that water body. Okay, to have bath in that municipal bath. So the water there was contaminated, and so he got to know about the contamination of water. So he is proven right after clinical visit. So what he does is he takes the water sample, he tests it. And then he finds that, of course, the water is contaminated. It has got spoiled and it is not good for the people's health to have bath in that water. So what he does is he wants to publish an article and expose the corruption. So why corruption? Because after he comes to know that the water here in this bath is not good, it is contaminated, he tells the people who are in charge of this bath. Okay, there are some people who run this, the municipal people who run this entire system. So he tells them, or he informs them, that the water here is contaminated and we need to stop the people to having bath over there. But they do not agree. And so what he wants to do is he wants to expose this kind of behavior of the municipal body to the people. And the best way to expose this behavior was to publish an article and to let the people know how there is corruption involved in allowing the people to have bath even when the water is contaminated. So what he does is he wants to, you know, publish this article, but his brother, elder brother, Peter Stockman, like I told you, he is the mayor of the town and he is also the chairman of the bath committee. So what he does is, now if his brother, that is Dr. Stockman, if he publishes an article like that, then it is going to put Peter Stockman in trouble because he was the one who would be questioned by the people. So what he does is he tells his brother, he warns him of terrible consequences for him and his family if he publishes the article. So what he says, in spite of him being his brother, he does not care for that. What he cares about is his position as the chairman of the bath committee, which would be in trouble if the article was published. So what he does is he goes to his brother's place and he gives him a warning that if you dare to put any kind of complaint against me or the bathing system, then you and your family will have a very, very great and terrible consequences. And so you should immediately stop thinking about doing such a thing of publishing the article. But Mr. Hofstad, we have, who is the editor of the People's Messenger, and Aslaksen, he's a printer. When Dr. Stockman goes to them, he understands that these two, that is a person who would be in charge of publishing the article and the printer, they also were hand in glove with Peter. It means that they were also joined with his elder brother. They had also joined his elder brother, Peter, and they decided not to publish the article. Okay, understood? So you understand how all of these, you know, when you're into a political system, when people are doing some kind of corruption, it is not just that one person, but there are many other people who are involved in such kind of acts, okay? And only with their together effort, when they all together, only then corruption takes place successfully. So here also we see Peter Stockman, he has joined hands with the editor of the paper and Aslaksen, who is a printer of the paper, and they both also refused to publish this article, which was for the welfare of the people. Okay, so they are also having the same share of corruption with Peter Stockman. So did you all understand till here? Okay. So Dr. Stockman, what he does is, now Peter Stockman, that is his brother, has come and warned him about the consequences. He went to the printer and the editor. They also have refused to publish the article. So what he does is, he decides to hold a town meeting. Okay, so he says, since I cannot publish the article and tell the people of what is going on, what I will do is, I'll collect all the people from the town. I will take a meeting and I will tell them that this is the problem. This is the problem that they are facing. This is a great difficulty, that is, they are going to have bath in the contaminated water, and I will make them aware of all the problems. So this meeting turns disastrous, in which town people shout, okay, because when he goes to tell the people, instead of listening to him, they start blaming him and they start saying that he is an enemy of the people. They don't believe what he's saying and they are not ready to listen to what he's saying. Okay, so even the people are blindly believing Peter Stockman and other people instead of listening to Dr. Stockman, and instead they start blaming Dr. Stockman for just wasting their time. So what they do is, they start throwing stones at his house. Windows are smashed. He becomes a target of people's ire, of the people's anger. His contract as medical officer is terminated. He is removed as a medical officer. He is asked to leave as a medical officer. Not only him, but his daughter, who is a teacher, she is also removed from her job. And his landlord, the place where he was staying, that person, that place owner, okay, tells Mr. Stockman and his family to empty the house and leave from there immediately. Okay, so these are all the consequences that he faces just for speaking the truth or just for standing up for the welfare of the people. Okay, so this is what happens even in the society today, my dear students. Okay, even today, a person, if he talks about the welfare of others, then he is immediately targeted and he is asked to keep his mouth shut, or he has to face all the major consequences. Why? Because if he speaks, then the political system, which is gaining profit by fooling people, is going to be at loss. And so any person who complains or dares to open his mouth to speak the truth, to speak for the rights of the people, he is immediately made to keep his mouth shut. So in this situation also, we see the Dr. Stockman, who was talking for the good of the people, that this water where you're having bath is contaminated, it's spoiled, it's not good for your health to have bath in that particular bathing system. And still people blindly would just believe the others, the political people, and not believe this particular doctor who was speaking for their good. And he had to face so many consequences, that is, his job was taken away, his daughter's job was taken away, his house was thrown stones at, his windows were smashed, his landlord had asked him to leave the house, and all these things he had to face just for speaking speaking good, or telling people of their good, what is good for them. But in spite of all these consequences, he does not step back. He stands firm in the face of difficulties and he ignores Peter's advice, that is his elder brother's advice, to leave the town for a few months. He says, I am not going to leave because I am not doing anything wrong. People who are doing wrong are still surviving. They are there here still. And if I am not doing anything wrong, then why should I leave the town? Okay, so he does not leave the town for a few months. But his wife is very much afraid that people might drive him out of the town. Because of course, if you know, a person, if the the in charge person or the main person in the house, if he is, you know, standing up for something good and the whole family is facing the consequences, then of course the family will be scared about what will happen to the person who is standing for the truth, about the person who is in charge of the family. Okay, so what if something happens to him? So his wife also was scared that what if something happens to his her husband, and what if they just throw him out of the town? So Dr. Stockman replies that he intends to stay and make the people understand that considerations of expediency turn morality and justice upside down. So he's saying, just, I'm not going to just leave like a coward. I'm going to stay and I'm going to fight this particular problem that everybody is facing. And I'm going to make the people understand that you don't have to, you know, just listen blindly to whatever is being told. You have to start reasoning. You have to start thinking as to what is right and what is wrong. And if you do not do that, then your morality and your justice, which you should all get, will definitely turn upside down. So what is convenient is not always morally right. My dear student, this sentence is very, very important. Most of the times we think of, you know, whatever is convenient, we go for all the convenient options, we go for all the easy options. But most of the time it is like that whenever we think of convenient things, those things are not always morally right. They are not always right things to be done. So he ends by proclaiming that the strongest man in the world is he who stands alone, because it takes a lot of courage, a lot of strength to stand alone and fight for what is right and fight for justice of other people. Okay, so likewise, like him, like Dr. Stockman, we have so many people in the history of our own country. We have Gandhiji, we have Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar, we have Mother Teresa, we have so many people who have stood alone for the rights of the people, who have stood alone just so that they could fight for the justice of the other people. Okay, and so we also, even today at this stage, when you are in this 11th standard, even today you can take such decisions wherein if so you are thinking about doing something good for others, and if that means that you have to stand alone, there is no problem in doing that. There is no problem in standing alone, because always remember, the strongest man in the world is the one who stands alone. So if you believe whatever you're doing is for the good of people, for the welfare of people, is morally right, then you must stand and speak for the rights of others. Okay, so this is what we get a lesson from this particular play, that is the enemy of the people, an enemy of the people. And Dr. Stockman tells a very beautiful message that we must always, not always go for convenient things and do it even if it is morally incorrect. We have to think if it is right or wrong, and if choosing the right things takes inconvenience, makes it inconvenient to you, still you have to choose for doing the right things and not just take the wrong path because it is convenient. Okay, so with this I end the plot of the play. In the next video we shall discuss the extract which is given in your textbook in a very detailed manner. Until then, please open your textbooks to this particular play, read the about the characters, about the plot of the play, the theme of the play. And of course, you can listen to this video again and again if you have not understood, and get to know about what this play is all about. And the detail of this play we shall discuss in next video. Till then, thank you and have a nice day.